since they must be belonging to genetics and plant breeding, this area of virus detection will be totally new, I'm sure. So I will go slowly so that it registers in your mind. And so how many of you have idea about plant viruses? Just raise your hand. None. Nobody. At graduation level, you must have studied. So viruses are unique pathogen. Until the end of 18th century, we were not aware about plant virus. We were only aware about fungi or fungal pathogen and bacteria. Then there was a disease in tobacco mosaic disease. And many scientists in Europe and Russia, they were trying to find out the etiology of the disease. And till then they had the concept it could be either fungi or bacteria, but both could be detected through microscope. But when they were trying to find out any bacteria, association of any bacteria or fungi, they were repeatedly failing. But they had no answer also, what could be the pathogen. So the most important discovery at the end of 18th century was by Martin W. Bezerink, who was teacher of botany at Agriculture College, Wesiningen, from 76 to 85, and then professor of microbiology, 95 to 91. As I said, he could not detect bacteria in the pathogen. Then he did some experiment. What he did, he tried to inoculate the sap from infected tobacco to healthy tobacco, and he could reproduce the disease. Okay. The other experiment which he did, and before him other scientists had done, to pass the sap through bacteria proof filter. If bacteria was there, it will be eliminated. When they passed the sap from infected plant, they found that the sap was still infectious. But as I said, they had no answer. So then he also did some agar diffusion test, and the causing agent could move. So he then coined the word contagium vivum fluidum. What does this mean? Contagium means infectious, vivum means living, fluidum. So it was not corpuscular, means it was not cellular, okay, unlike bacteria and fungi. So he coined the term fluidum. So that is how the origin of plant viruses started. Then, as we could see fungi and bacteria through microscope, but viruses could not be seen, plant viruses, until the discovery of electron microscope. So in 1939, for the first time, tobacco mosaic virus, which was initially studied, the particle was visualized through electron microscope, and at that time the size was given 15 nanometer into 300 nanometer. You can imagine the size, which is so small, but that was at that time. Now it is 18 nanometer into 300 nanometer. Then how do we define plant viruses? That is very important. So it is one or more nucleic acid template molecules normally encased in a protective coat or coats of protein or lipoprotein, which is able to organize its own replication only within a suitable host cell. So viruses are non-living outside host cell. They become living only in the host cell. Okay. So since the discovery of plant viruses, so this is the electron microscopic picture. They look like rigid rod. If you can, I think there is a lot of light. Can you see a central line? So that you can see through electron microscope, and that represents nucleic acid. Okay. So if you see in electron microscope any virus particle, if they are spherical, there will be a dot in the center representing nucleic acid. If it is rigid rod or flexuous, there could be a central canal which indicates the presence of. So there are many virus particles which are empty, they don't have nucleic acid. In that case, you don't see this central canal. So since the discovery of tobacco mosaic virus, now we have more than 1500 plant viruses. How many? 1500 plant viruses. And as I said, they consist of only nucleic acid and coat protein. So in the nucleic acid, it is either RNA or DNA. So based on this genetic constitution and the shape of size and many other factors, they are classified as single-stranded RNA, positive sense, single-stranded RNA, negative sense, double-stranded RNA, single-stranded RNA, double-stranded DNA. So more than 70% of plant viruses are RNA virus. Okay, so other than TMB, are you aware of any other RNA virus? Which crop you have worked? Anyone can tell me. Yellow vein mosaic virus in? Bhindi. Bhindi yellow vein mosaic virus. Okay, any other? Cauliflower mosaic virus. Tungro virus. Of course, among these three, the Bhindi yellow mosaic virus is quite prominent, quite common. Wherever okra is grown, you always seen yellow vein mosaic virus. And that is caused by a DNA virus, single-stranded DNA virus, which belongs to Gemini viridae. Okay. The one who said cauliflower mosaic virus, it doesn't occur in India. Okay, it is double-stranded DNA virus. The one who said Tungro virus is again double-stranded DNA virus. Earlier it was in Bedna virus, a genus, but now it is of having own genera is called Tungro virus. Okay, so as I said, 1500 viruses and many of the crops which we grow in the field, they may be infected by one or more than one plant, that we more than one virus, that we will see. So as I said, there are more than 1500 viruses. How to diagnose them? You said Bhindi yellow vein mosaic virus. By seeing the symptom, we can only say it is Bhindi yellow vein mosaic disease. We cannot say it is being caused by Bhindi yellow vein mosaic virus. Why, I will tell you later. So to diagnose the virus infecting any crop in the field, there are various methodology. One is field-based symptoms. So based on the symptom, just like she said, Bhindi yellow vein mosaic disease possibly caused by Bhindi yellow vein mosaic virus. So there will be distinct symptom. You might have seen the symptom of leaf curl disease in tomato. How many of you have seen leaf curl in tomato? I think many of you have seen. So it is also caused by a Gemini virus, double-stranded DNA virus. And all these bigomoviruses, they belong to bigomovirus, they are transmitted by white fly in nature. So in tomato, as I said, tomato leaf curl virus, you know how many, there is no species now called as tomato leaf curl virus. There are more than dozen virus species. How many? Dozen virus species which cause tomato leaf curl virus. So when you are screening a tomato germplasm, suppose, against tomato leaf curl disease, you can only say you are screening against tomato leaf curl disease. The moment you are using the word tomato leaf curl virus, which species? So they are named first. The species which was named causing tomato leaf curl disease was tomato leaf curl New Delhi species, because it was taken from here and the genome was characterized. So that way other species were named like tomato leaf curl Varanasi virus, tomato leaf curl Udaipur virus, tomato leaf curl Palampur virus. So why these names are important? If you are breeding for resistance against tomato leaf curl virus in Delhi condition, the resistance source which you have found, if you are going to evaluate that in Palampur or maybe in Gujarat, that may not be the resistant, for simple reason that the virus species has changed. So earlier what we used to say, अरे यहाँ तो आपने रेजिस्टेंस हो किया, ये तो रेजिस्टेंट नहीं है, हमारे यहाँ तो इट इज़ नॉट रेजिस्टेंस अगेंस्ट द सेम डिजीज. सो आइदर यू हैव डन सम मिस्टेक, बट ही हैज नॉट डन एनी मिस्टेक. इट इज़ बिकॉज द वायरस स्पीसीज देयर वाज डिफरेंट देन हियर. सो यू हैव इवेल्युएटेड रेजिस्टेंस अगेंस्ट दिस स्पीसीज, नॉट अगेंस्ट दैट स्पीसीज. सो इफ इट इज शोइंग रेजिस्टेंस देयर, देन यू कैन से इट इज ऑल्सो रेजिस्टेंस अगेंस्ट टोमेटो लीफ कर्ल गुजरात वायरस. So that is how this detection and proper characterization is important. So what are the other different tools? Field symptom based. When modern tools were not available, biological indexing was done. That was called biological method. So these viruses will produce a specific symptom in a particular host plant. The virus risk study is very difficult. That is why many people in most of the universities, those who are in plant pathology, never opt for virology. They will go for fungus or bacteria because they can easily culture in the plate and study under microscope. But science of virology is complex and it is changing with the change in the science in molecular biology. So biological indexing was done, but again this is very difficult. You require control greenhouses, you have to raise plants, then you have to inoculate by sap or by vector. So, and result will come after a long time. But many times this has been used for finding source of resistance in tree crop, like citrus, where plants are infected with severe mild strain, and then they are grafted with the severe strain and one can find the resistance. But CTV, for example, Citrus Tricija virus, which means sadness, can be detected through biological means. It produces typical symptom in sour orange, okay? But that symptom production is only during low temperature. So biological indexing is no more very useful. It is useful only for research and academic purpose. Electron microscopy, wherever it is available, it can be used to study the structure of virus. Can we use electron microscopy for characterization of a specific virus? My question is, how many of you say yes or say no? Anybody has any exposure to electron microscopy? No, we have electron microscopy. In fact, if your coordinator has time, you can go and see the virus structure. The structure which I showed for TMB, which was showing rigid rod, the structure will tell you that this is a particular virus belonging to a genera, not it cannot be identified as a specific species. Like the rod-shaped virus, typically same shape and size, you will get a virus infecting cucumber, caused by cucumber green mottle mosaic virus. But it is totally different. If you see under electron microscope, it will show typical shape and size of tobacco mosaic virus. So people will say it is tobacco mosaic virus, but the fact is it is not tobacco mosaic virus. It is completely different from tobacco mosaic virus, and that is called cucumber green mottle mosaic virus based on the nucleotide sequence and other properties. So, and then immunological and nucleic acid based. These are the two most widely used techniques for identification and characterization of virus. So we will discuss about that one by one. So earlier I was showing ki based on symptoms, you cannot identify the virus. Like in mung bean yellow mosaic disease is there, which is caused by four species of Begomo virus. In papaya leaf, this is shoestring disease. Along with you get leaf curled symptom. So they are caused by two different viruses. One is papaya ring spot virus, other one is papaya leaf curled virus. Similarly, in citrus, you can see mixed infection. This symptom is caused by mosaic virus, but along here, that picture is not there, but along with that, you will also get flexuous virus. And similarly, the other, this is banana bunchy top, caused by banana bunchy top virus. So this one can say it is caused by banana bunchy top virus because no other virus has been associated so far. So all these viruses in nature, how they transmit? So the vectors are the most important carrier of plant viruses. What are the important vectors? Okay. So white fly, aphids, beetle, thrips, leafhoppers, mealybugs. Among them, three are most important. White flies, aphids, and thrips. I'm not going into detail of their virus vector or virus vector host relationship. So if you have interest, you can go through some textbook or you can Google it. The other method of transmission, which is also widely we see in nature, is through seed. So many of our problems in crop plant, field crops particularly, whether it is vegetables, whether it is horticultural crops, we have got through importing material that we will see. One example, I will see, who is from Karnataka? Okay, so you must be knowing sunflower necrosis disease, which is caused by a virus called ILAR virus, and it is mechanically transmitted by thrips, mechanically through wings. So this virus was not there in sunflower. This virus came through seeds of soybean in India, and it found a nick in the sunflower, and then it caused epidemic in 90s and later on. So seeds are the biggest threat for any crop because it is very difficult to detect them. Then many of the vegetatively propagated crop like sugar cane, banana, onion, garlic, they are also carrier of viruses. So there are two types of transmission. One is horizontal transmission, other one is horizontal, other one is vertical transmission. So transmission by insect is horizontal transmission from one plant to another plant, but vertical transmission from mother plant to progeny, okay, like sugar cane, banana. So these are many of the ornamental plants. So what is the relevance of, people say, what is the relevance of diagnostics? If you see this slide, there is always huge loss, economic loss in terms of yield, quality, and productive life. If you see tomato in market, if you see, you often see yellow spot. Do you see? So that is caused by a TOSPO virus, which we have characterized. Earlier, people who are not from the virology field, they will instantly say tomato spotted wilt virus. but that is not the causal virus. The causal virus belonging to same genus, sister species, is groundnut bud necrosis virus. So that virus was initially described in groundnut, and that has moved to tomato and other plants. So it reduces the quality. Papaya, all of you must have seen rings on the fruit. Then productive life. Many of the crops like grape wine, which are perennial in nature, citrus, if viruses are there, you may not see symptom. Or garlic, you find the bulb size this year bigger. Next year, if you grow the same close, the bulb size will reduce, and there is a gradual degeneration. In potato too, this is a degeneration problem. So productive life is gradually reduced, and farmers are not aware. So there is a huge economic loss. Then if all plants are infected, like we were screening here garlic accessions. So out of 50, 48 were infected by more than two viruses. Two or more than two viruses. So that was only possible through diagnostic tool, which we'll discuss. So it is often difficult to get healthy clonal material. So then correct identification and indexing of viruses are prerequisite. So unless you identify the virus, you cannot index for freedom from viruses. For example, if I say grapevine, we'll take one example. You are going to index for freedom from virus. Which virus? So unless you know the virus, you cannot index whether that virus is present or absent. Then virus diagnostics are also essential for sanitary and phytosanitary certification. When we import material, if we do not have diagnostics, the phytosanitary people, they simply allow there is no virus because they are not having capability to test them. So in the process, we introduce many virus, many viruses in our country. Then another thing, in grape leaf roll associated virus free plants in California gave benefit of over 100 times the cost of testing. So if we do indexing, in turn what we get good healthy planting material that will bear for long duration. So the cost which we are incurring by way of testing is very much compensated. Now, what are the challenges for viruses? Most of the time, viruses occur in low concentration. So that is a challenge to detect them. Many of the plant viruses are not characterized. So as I have already said, unless you characterize them, you cannot go for detection. Third, the diagnostic reagent, I mean testing reagent for ELISA is antibodies. If for many viruses, antibodies are not available. So you have characterized the virus, but you don't have antibodies. So you cannot do serological test. Then many of the plants have, you go for PCR or RT-PCR based detection. So how many of you are aware about PCR and RT-PCR? Almost all. So what are the components? We will talk a little later. So one of the important component is preparation of template, nucleic acid template, which you do either by laboratory methods or you use kits. Okay. So it is a complex protocol, labor intensive. So that is also deterrent for diagnostics. And then the most important one is that plants in nature are not always infected by one virus. Many of the crop plants, in field crops as well as vegetatively propagated crops, they will have multiple virus infection. So how to detect them? That is also a big challenge. And then there will be many viruses which we do not know even today. So their detection will go unnoticed. So these are the challenges of virus detection. So I will just give you one example of grape vine viruses. Grape is the most highest earning income through export in fruit crops, okay, in from India. And till 2008 or 2010, when we started working, there was no official report from India of any virus which could infect grape in India. Then there was a news in 2008 that in Maharashtra, leaf roll disease has suddenly appeared, and farmers were very much worried. Okay, but somehow there was no evidence that which virus is associated. So we were asked to initiate work in 2010. So I myself went to Maharashtra along with the director of NRC grape. We surveyed some of the area and we brought samples. And based on the literature, we found that at that time, we found that there was association of 11 viruses with the leaf roll disease. So then we further narrowed down which are the important one. Then we found that two viruses are very important which can cause leaf roll disease. So that name was given as grape leaf roll associated virus 1 and grape leaf roll associated virus 3. So we procured anti-sera or so these are the nursery from where we, you can see leaf roll symptom, reddening and leaf roll symptom. He is director of, now he is vice chancellor, Dr. I'm forgetting, Savant. So this is a picture of 2010. This is a nursery in Maharashtra and all plants were infected. So when these plants are going to the farmer fields, they are all infected because they have not been indexed, they have been not tested. And the leaf roll disease can cause growth and yield reduction by from 10 to 70%, delayed maturity of grapes by 25 to 50% in sugar content, and lifespan reduction will be up to 50%. So in California, there is a registration and certification program which led to reduction in viruses in that place, but here we do not have. And this is the benefit of indexing program in USA. I will not go. So I was just talking about which are the important viruses which can be associated with leaf roll disease. So we worked on these two viruses and we used the two most common method, ELISA and PCR. And do I need to tell about the ELISA? How many of you are aware ELISA? No. How many of you? Okay, few of them. Just broadly to discuss ki each virus produces in if they are injected in a purified form in a mammalian system, they produce specific antibodies, okay? And using that antibodies, we can see the presence or absence of virus. So simple method is here that you add the antibody. If you want to test, suppose grape leaf roll associated virus 3, you get the antibody specific to that, then you add the sap, okay? If virus is present, this virus is present, then it will bind to the antibody. So this is basically serology, study of interaction between antigen and antibody. But you cannot see that reaction. So to see that reaction, we have to add a conjugated enzyme, which is an enzyme conjugated with an antibody, which may be against the same virus or antibody against the primary antibody, okay? And once you have, if virus is present, that antibody will bind here with the enzyme, then you add substrate and yellow color will develop. So this is the format of ELISA. There are different formats, but the most common and most efficient one is double antibody sandwich ELISA, what we call here. So then you, through naked eye, you can see in the healthy plant, there will be no color development. In infected plant, there will be yellow color. But one can quantify through optical density at 405 in an ELISA reader. So if value is more than 2 times, then healthy plant, we call them positive. So using this method, one has to use positive control, negative control, and buffer control. So in 2010, we collected from different vineyards, different varieties, and you can see that GLRB3 was common in most of the wine bar. And in couple of the wine yard, we could also find the association of GLRB1. So this was the first record which we made, and then we went for one PhD student work on the characterization of this virus and production of antibody. So this training is about genomics in crop improvement. So just to lighten you, that I just told you that antibodies are produced by injecting purified virus. But purification of virus, I mean to separate virus from other plant cell organelles, is a very, very complex process. Okay? And it takes weeks, and after even purification, still you end up with the many plant proteins. So when you introduce those purified virus, you generally do not get a very good quality antibodies. And another disadvantage is that antibody is over, then again you have to go for virus purification. And many of the viruses, we know that they are found in very low concentration. So purification is always complex. So when molecular biology started developing, when gene sequences became available, then recombinant technology was used, using the gene sequences of the virus for production of antibodies. Now, how it was done? Because these antibodies are produced because of the coat protein, which is covering the virus nucleic acid. So they have epitopes, which are responsible for antibody production. So what was done, that the coat protein gene in the virus was identified, and then that was first cloned, sequenced, confirmed, and then that sequence was used in expression vector. So in case of grapevine leaf roll associated virus 3, and we also did for 4 here, we went for, this is the supposed coat protein gene. So this was amplified, okay? And then it was put in an expression vector. And after that, the coat protein was purified and then injected into rabbit, and then you got the antibodies. So that is how you have completely dispensed the use of purification of plant viruses. So as I said in the beginning of my talk, the science of virology has been changing with the change in molecular biology. So recombinant technology, when it came, it was successfully used, and we have done for more than several dozen of viruses at Advanced Center of Plant Virology. So this was induced, expressed, then we confirmed through Western blotting, and then this protein was used for production of antibodies. So as I said, when we started working with this leaf roll disease, we found the association of 11 viruses. Subsequently, we found that there are only 5 viruses, 1, 2, 3, 4, and 7. Not 3, 4, 7, and 9. So the grape leaf roll associated virus 4, we could detect through, we had developed a chip at our center. Using that chip, we could detect this virus in the same plant which we had collected in 2010. So again, we went through coat protein expression, produced the antibodies, and when we used this antibody for prevalence of this virus in vineyard of Maharashtra, to our surprise, in 18 vines of 14 cultivars were positive, 9 vines of 8 cultivars were positive with GLRB4, in 2016-17, 23 vines of 15 cultivars were infected with this. So this virus was more dominant and prevalent than GLRB3R1. So this is how strong the detection tools are. If you have antibodies, you can determine. So most of these viruses have come through importing material. In fact, the farmers of Maharashtra had imported elite varieties of grapevine. So NRC grape sent, it has to be come through NVPGR or through quarantine centers. So NVPGR did not have that capability. They sent those samples to us. I have probably deleted that one. Yes. So we found that 3 of the samples out of 11 were positive with GLRB4 and GLRB1. So we asked them to destroy them. Because it is now here, but that may be a different strain. Polyclonal antibodies broadly detect the virus. But if there are strains, that we cannot distinguish them. Okay. So this was the initial story about grapevine. I will come one example of field crop. Soybean, how many of you have heard, seen soybean? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay. In soybean, which virus you come across? Good. Mosaic. So caused by soybean yellow mosaic virus, which is a bigomo virus transmitted by white fly. I will just narrate one story. I hope I am not keeping you waited for lunch. Okay. So in soybean, here also comes mosaic. Soybean mosaic virus, which is a flexuous virus. That yellow vein mosaic is a double-shaped virus, DNA virus. Soybean mosaic virus is a flexuous RNA virus transmitted by aphids. So one resistant breeding program screening was being done, and one PhD student was given. So she was working and trying to find out this virus. She did a lot of ELISA, and the virus was not being detected, maybe in one or two samples. At the same time, we gave one student to characterize this virus, soybean mosaic virus. He also started in MSc, you know, the time is very short. So 3 months he struggled, and he was not able to detect that virus. Then we were very much puzzled. He wanted to do coat protein gene sequencing, characterize the virus. Then we scanned literature, and then we found that in some other countries, South Africa, there is another virus reported in soybean causing mosaic disease, cowpea mild motile virus. But we said maybe because gene sequence, if you design primer, it may or may not amplify. So that belongs to a different group called Corla virus, different from Porty virus. Now, Corla virus is transmitted by white fly. Both are flexuous. In electron microscope, we were finding the same virus particle, flexuous. But we were not able to amplify or detect through ELISA for Porty virus, soybean mosaic virus. So when we found that information, we designed a degenerate primer. Degenerate, you understand, it can amplify a number of virus in that genus or that strain species if they are different. So, and luckily we got the amplification. So we thought whatever screening was being done, that was not correct, because you were thinking it is soybean mosaic virus, but it was totally different white fly transmitted virus. So then he went for cloning and characterization, and MSc student published a very good paper in Journal of Phytobiology with high rating. So subsequently, one of our colleagues had joined our center, and she started working on soybean field here under All India Coordinated Research Program. And you will be surprised to know that in the same year, she could detect 7 viruses. How many? 7. So the names are here: bean yellow mosaic virus through ELISA, black gram motile virus through ELISA, cowpea mild motile virus through RT-PCR, cucumber mosaic virus through ELISA, groundnut bud necrosis through ELISA, mung bean yellow mosaic India virus through PCR, soybean mosaic virus through RT-PCR, tobacco ring spot virus through ELISA, and tobacco streak virus. In how many accessions? 21 to, in some accession, these two viruses were not found. But in other accessions, a large number of accessions were positive. So these viruses was tested and seven viruses were found, 3, 3, 6, 3, 9. So nine viruses were tested and seven were present in the same year. Can you imagine this? So then she also wanted to test how many of them have mixed infection of how many virus. So you can see one accession had infection of as many as 5 virus in different combination. So 3, 2, some accessions had only one virus, like tobacco streak virus, which is an ILR virus, was found in one accession. So this was a very detailed study. So we wanted to find out which growth stages, which viruses were there. So you can see that initially we got necrosis and yellow mosaic, then complete yellow mosaic, then necrotic specks, bud blight, death in some genotype, and then finally green mosaic and mottled came at the end. And most of the plants were yellow mosaic and necrosis at the end, mixed infection when we found. So these are the symptoms, and we have given the name of viruses. You can see that based on symptom, it is very, very difficult to tell which virus is associated. So as a breeder, as a geneticist, one should be very clear that if you are going for a screening of resistance or a screening of any accession against any viral disease, you should definitely test them based on either ELISA or through RT-PCR. So one of our PhD students is currently doing 500 genotypes screening of soybean against 2-3 viruses. So these are again symptoms. You can see different yellow mosaic necrosis on green mottle and necrosis and different viruses associated. So this was, I have taken two examples, one vegetatively propagated, one field grafts. So just now we talked about ELISA and PCR, we'll be talking a little later. So the conventional ELISA takes about 1 to 1.5 day. But now dip stick methods have come wherein you have to spend only 10 to 15 minutes, just like pregnancy tests. So you just have to take the sap, add into the strip, and after 10 minutes, if both the lines appear, that means that virus is present. So this is commercially available for many viruses by Agdia and other companies. We have also tried, but we have not been very successful in many cases. PCR based, I said, what are the components? DNA template, primers, DNTPs, magnesium ion, polymerase, reaction buffer. Okay. I will just go to this I will skip. How many of you have done DNA isolation? Okay. So you have been using chloroform, phenol, isoamyl if you are doing laboratory based method. Okay. But we developed a method where you can dispense the use of chloroform, phenol, isoamyl, and simply by grinding the leaf tissue, and then you can add the isopropanol after clarification of the sap, and DNA is precipitated. So this we did for a DNA virus in citrus, and that was published in Journal of Virological Method and highly cited paper. Then we also further simplified DNA template preparation. You can just grind the tissue in a specific buffer and spot on the NCM membrane. And then you can bring it to the lab. You have to screen, suppose, hundreds of field crops. Just grind there in the polythene bag, spot on the NCM membrane, bring it to the lab, just punch it out, heat it in water, DNA template is ready. So that is another method of, we have compared with the commercial kit and laboratory method, and you can see the amplification almost in similar in all cases. Then plants are infected by, as I said, multiple viruses. So one can go for multiplex. Initially we did for duplex, and then we have done for 5 pathogens, 4 viruses, 1 bacterium in case of citrus. So multiplex is another method where if you have more than one virus infection, one can go for. What I am, I will just skip this. Yes. So can you imagine a PCR amplification without DNA amplification, DNA template preparation, without thermal cycler? Can you tell any method? It is there, you must have heard. LAMP. How many of you have heard? No? Isothermal amplification, you have not heard. So isothermal amplification was developed to replace the thermal cycler, where you have to go for denaturation, annealing, and extension. Isothermal means at the same temperature, all these things are happening. Okay, so, but in LAMP, you can Google search what is LAMP. Nucleic acid isolation was still required, okay, DNA. But what we have done, we have dispensed the use of nucleic acid isolation, we have dispensed the use of thermal cycler, and you can perform the PCR amplification and RT-PCR in less than half an hour. How much? DNA amplification takes 2 hours. So whole process takes 6 hours. Here the whole process can be completed in less than 1 hour.
I will just show.
So this is called recombinase polymerase amplification, RPA. It is a novel isothermal amplification which was first introduced in 2016 by Pippenberg to test pathogen Staphylococcus aureus. It is highly simple, extremely quick. Reaction is carried within 20 to 30 minutes at 37 to 42. So we have seen that even if you keep the tube at room temperature, PCR amplification is done. Okay. So as I said, no DNA template isolation is required. Crude SAP can be used. And the reaction mixer comprised of 2 sets of primer, just like PCR, 1 crude SAP. And the enzyme is mixture of 3 components, and that comes in a lyophilized form. That is what we call recombinase polymerase enzyme. I will not go the method. So it was first used for animal viruses in 2012. In plant viruses, it was used in 2014. And in India, we were the first to use it in 2016, and we published in a very high-rated journal, Archives of Virology, in 2017 and 2019 for 2 different viruses. So it is very simple. Just grind either in polythene bag and take 1 drop in a reconstituted buffer of this dry pellet enzyme, and then keep at dry bath at 37 or at room temperature, doesn't matter. And then you can run on the gel and you get the amplification. And this we have compared with the conventional PCR. We have compared more than 130 samples, and all samples which were positive in PCR using purified DNA were also positive in RPA, this method. So efficiency was almost identical, okay? And you can see here the PCR based and here RPA based. So in this method, it is, you don't require state of art lab. You just require recombinase polymerase enzyme, polythene bags. You just grind it, add it in reconstituted buffer, keep at room temperature for 25 to 30 minutes, and you can run on the gel, PCR amplification is done. So that is the most simplest form of PCR. It can be used for any purpose. And that we have tested for DNA virus, like in banana bunchitta virus. We have also done, this was published in Archives of Virology 2017. We have also standardized for an RNA virus, cucumber mosaic virus, which infects more than 1,000 host plants. So here we wanted to dispense the use of gel imaging. So we designed a probe, and that was very useful. So initially we tried in real-time PCR, and you can see that within 10 minutes, it is giving amplification. Crude extract, nothing, okay? And under UV lamp, you can see in healthy, there is no fluorescence. In infected plant, there is a fluorescence. So, and here you can see using RNA, and this is crude extract, same method. And when you do with crude extract, there is no amplification, RT-PCR. So we have evaluated the sensitivity, and it was identical with conventional RT-PCR. And then we have tested a large number of samples in banana, and the efficiency was as good as conventional PCR. So we wanted to develop, dispense the use of thermal cycler or real-time PCR. So we had a portable fluorescent meter, but it was not as efficient as real-time PCR. So we are further working on this. So last section. As I said, from one virus, TMB in 1896, to now we have more than 1,500 virus. So in 2011, we conceived the idea of DNA chip, and we collaborated with a company called Affymetrix, and we got the small probes of 25 nucleotide from 7 different places of virus genome. On this chip, and then this chip could detect any of the 1100 known viruses at that time. So this is the most smart parallel detection of viruses. In multiplex, you can detect 5 to maximum 8 viruses. But here, any virus, so this is very useful for biosecurity. If you are importing material, suppose grapevine we are importing, which is, I did not tell you earlier, which is host of more than 5 dozen viruses. We cannot go on testing all the viruses, but using this chip, we can detect. So we use this chip for detection of viruses in grapevine. And we could detect a large number of viruses and virvade in the same plant. You can see, using that chip, we could detect Rupestris virus, grapevine virvade, several virvades, and then grapevine leaf roll associated virus 4, which I was mentioning earlier. So using this chip only, we had come to know about the presence of this virus. And then for unknown viruses, I was talking about what are the challenges. So we can go for next generation sequencing. And we have used this deep sequencing again for detection of a virus. You must be aware of Urdbeen leaf crinkle disease. How many of you are aware? So it was, the disease was described in 1968, but till today we do not know which virus is causing this disease. Till today, in spite of all advancement. So we used NGS, and we came across again a copy mild motile virus in this crop. But later on, next year when we wanted to test this virus, this virus was not present in the field crop, and disease was there. So it is still baffling that which virus or virvade is associated. So NGS is nothing. It can only tell you the sequences. But again, you have to do biological work to prove postulate whether that virus is really causing the disease or not. So still now, this is a still enigma. Which virus or virvade is causing this disease. So we also use for grapevine NGS, and these are the students and SRF who have worked and contributed in all these studies. Thank you all. I think I've taken more than 1 hour or just enough. So thank you so much for your patience hearing, and if I have any question, I
You are welcome.
तो या तो लेक्चर बहुत कॉम्प्लेक्स था, समझ में नहीं आया, या इसमें कुछ है. Must ask.
Sir, in Gujarat we have infection of, leaf yination virus in okra. Present status regarding sequencing and
sequencing error. You are getting sequencing error.
Status.
अच्छा okay. Yes, it has been sequenced for Bigomo viruses earlier. These viruses were identified based on the coat protein gene, which is a smaller. But all the Bigomo viruses are 2.7 kb DNA circular molecule. If you get complete genome sequence, based on that only you can identify whether it is leaf yination virus, bhindi leaf yination virus, or okra leaf yination virus. Or it is bhindi yellow vein mosaic virus. In fact, in vegetable field here also, we got both mosaic symptom, yellow vein mosaic symptom, and yination also. So we have done sequencing, but we have not got the full genome. Based on a small sequence, we are saying that it is leaf yination virus. But to say with confirmation, one has to go for full genome sequencing. If you can get that, then only you can say. ठीक है? The cutoff. Between one virus species with other virus species in Bigomo virus is only 9%. So if you get the whole genome sequence and the difference is more than 9%, then only it will be called as a different species. Okay. So based on, and if it is showing less than 9% similar difference, then it will be assigned to that species to which it is showing closest proximity.
When we go to field, in field condition, we'll find how we can differentiate whether plant is affected by disease or nutrient deficiency or pest.
Okay. Nutrient deficiency, you can confirm by adding the nutrient. That will recover the plant. My knowledge says that. But if it is disease, whatever you add, there will be no change in the status of plant, particularly viral disease. Okay. Number two, nutrient deficiency may not be uniform, may not be. Depending upon if it is a particular location, there is a more water or less nutrient of particular. So it may be specific at one site, not be uniform. So that is another difference one can make out. But disease, by experience, one can definitely say. Okay. So any example you have?
No, sir. generally, I'm asking because we'll be always having doubt, no, sir, whether it is affected by pest, disease, or elements.
Nutrient deficiency can be always overcome by adding nutrient, but not the disease. And the other method is you bring it, if it is viral, you have to confirm through test. If it is fungal, you have to culture it and tell, prove the Coase postulate if it is continuously occurring in entire crop season. And also your own experience will matter.
Because sir, if we go village side, they will ask us, farmers will ask us, what is the problem for this, reason for this symptoms?
Yeah.
We won't be able to say whether it is.
Yeah, but now symptom is definitely a guide to tell you whether it is caused by a disease, because many of the software are available, you know, plant vac, plant text or something like that. You just click the photo and you put it there, it will analyze and it can tell you based on the database it is having. So it is not always easy to say that which virus or which disease is there if particularly someone is not so experienced. But someone is having complete knowledge about that crop, he can definitely tell whether it is caused by a nutrient deficiency or a pathogen. Okay.
single stranded RNA. Is it only for taxonomy purpose or any other purpose?
It is for taxonomy purpose, because based on that, in case of viruses, this nucleic acid sequences are ultimate for characterization of viruses, ultimate. So unless you know